me a favor and let me give you what I believe God gave for us tonight. It's gonna be a great night. If you have your Bibles or if you have your Bible app, pull up the YouVersion Bible app, and there's an event created. It's just called Speed the Light at our location. Click on that. You can follow right along. All of our announcements are on there. You can double check those later. It's gonna be a good night. But if you have your Bible, do me a favor. Jump to your feet. We're gonna read the amazing Word of God, and we're gonna honor it by standing as we read it. Okay? All right. Check this out. In the book of Judges, Old Testament, six books in, something like that. Chapter 6. We're gonna start at verse 11. I'll give you the backstory of what's happened. Prior to verse 11, here just a second, but here we go. The Word of God says this: the angel of the Lord came down and sat under the oak tree in Ophrah. That says Ophrah, right? That says Ophrah. Okay. That's what I said, Ophrah. That belonged to Joash, the Abizurite. There you go. Where his son Gideon, that's who I'm really talking about tonight, Gideon, was threshing wheat in a wine press to keep it from the Midianites. When the angel of the Lord appeared to Gideon and said, he said, "The Lord is with you, mighty warrior." "But sir," Gideon replied, "if the Lord is with us, why has all this happened to us? Why are all where are all the wonders that our fathers told us about when they said, 'Did not the Lord bring us up out of Egypt?' But now the Lord has abandoned us and put us into the hands of the Midianites. The Lord turned to him and said, "Go in the strength you have and save Israel from Midian's hand. Am I not sending you?" "But Lord," Gideon asked, "how can I save Israel? My clan is the weakest in Manasseh, and I am the least in my family." Verse 16 says this: "The Lord answered, 'I will be with you.'" So, Lord, I thank you for your presence, and I so thank you for your word. God, let tonight just be enlightening. Let tonight be so much fun and so interesting, God, that no one would even think about ignoring what you've got to say tonight. God, speak on them in only the way you can, because I know I have nothing to give the students. But God, through you, we can do all things. God, I love you and I thank you. High five somebody and take a seat. All right. Hey, we are going to break down this particular passage of scripture, and it's going to, if you allow it to, it will be challenging for you in a very good way. So let's start in verse number 12, all right? Verse number 12 says this. It says, "When the angel of the Lord appeared to Gideon, he said, 'The Lord is with you.'" Can I ask you a quick question about that? Does anything else matter in your life if you have that phrase, "The Lord is with you"? That's enough. That's it. You're good. That's all. Nothing else matters. If you've got everything you need right there, you should be good. If you believe that the Bible is truth, if you believe that Jesus is truth, then when he said, "I am always with you, even to the very ends of the age," you have absolutely everything you need, and you're done. I am with you. We will never have a true need. We will never experience true need as long as we remain in the vine, as long as we remain in relationship with Jesus. Whatever God has called you to do, you know, God doesn't create you on accident. He created you for a purpose and with a purpose. Y'all understand that, right? That's kind of what God does. It's who he is. He's amazing. So he didn't create you on accident. He created you with a purpose. And so whatever he has created you to do, well, get up and do it. Why? Because the Lord is with you, so you're going to be successful. There's no questioning what's going to happen. Well, the Lord's with you, and you're doing what he's called you to do, you're good. But how? Well, the Lord is with you. That's how. Just get up and do it. The Lord is with you. And then the angel flips completely and says, and calls this scared, pathetic little farmer a mighty warrior. He says, "The Lord is with you, mighty warrior." Can I read a little bit? Verse 11, jump back to verse 11, and let me explain what a mighty warrior they're talking about halfway down, where his son Gideon was threshing wheat. He was like farming and putting together whatever threshing means, wheat, in a wine press. He was hiding from the bad guys, the Midianites. He was doing whatever he was doing, and here's the backstory. Here's why he was hiding. Verse number 6, I didn't give you this one. Verse number 6 says, Midian so impoverished the Israelites that they cried out to the Lord for help. Previous to this, the word of God says in verse 1, chapter 6, again, the Israelites did evil in the eyes of the Lord. This is the entire theme of the book of Judges. Again, the Israelites did evil in the eyes of the Lord. What a bunch of idiots. They wait until they have a verse 6 in almost every chapter. It says, the Midian so impoverished the Israelites that they cried out for help. Why do we tend to wait so long until we're impoverished before we cry out for help? Why? When we know that I am with you, the Lord is with you all the time. Why do we wait until we are desperate to get us some Jesus? That doesn't make any sense to me. It just kind of seems dumb. So, you know, I call it like I see it. Why wait? The Lord is with you, mighty warrior. Gideon is hiding. But you know, when we listen and we hear the voice of God, we've been talking about the bump. Hearing the bump. When we hear the voice of God, God can look at us and call out the warrior from within the farmer. God looks at you and he redirects Gideon's destiny. He redirects your destiny. No matter where you are, no matter where you're hiding out, God will redirect your destiny. There's so much more to you than meets the eye. There's so much more to you than the world sees. And I would venture to say there's so much more to you than even you see. What you look at in the mirror going back and forth is like, oh, dude. The Lord is with you, mighty warrior. Look at someone and say, you kind of scare me there, warrior. Look at someone and say, come on. You're scaring me, warrior. You're scaring me, warrior. Ah! Whatever. Okay, the Lord is with you, mighty warrior. God does not call us to just exist. He calls us to live. We are so good at just existing, just going through the motions. When God doesn't call us to just exist and be here, he calls us to live and to do it in a godly way. We have to live to abundance. You understand that? Christ came that we might have life to abundance. Life to abundance. And so God understands how to call out the potential from our preparation. Let me explain this. What we view as boring and monotonous and annoying, so like school, chores, work, God views that as potential. Potential. The more you put in right now with the preparation that you have, that you have allotted to, the greater the potential you have to do something for God. If you're just kind of lackadaisical in your preparation right now, later is just going to kind of be all lackadaisical. Oh. But if you do the work now, if you understand a concept that leaders, true leaders, are readers, you'll get over the fact that I hate reading. I'm the same way. I hated reading. But when I understood that's a type of preparation for my potential explosion later, you can wrap your head around, okay, I need to read this book. I need to get through my schoolwork and do it in a quality way, not just rush. Your preparation, God knows how to look at your preparation and define your potential within that. What you develop today, right now, dictates your future. The decisions you make right now will immediately determine your tomorrows. The decisions you make today will determine your tomorrows. The word of Jesus said in the book of Luke, those who are faithful with the little things, they will also be faithful in the greater things as well. Poor preparation leads to a floppy future. You may look and feel like a scared farmer, but God looks at you and says, the Lord is with you, mighty warrior. Go to verse 13. Here's Gideon's reply. But sir, like he's immediately argumentative. He says, but sir, I love Bible buds, but this one's really dumb. Like you see a but in the Bible, usually it's a bad followed by a negative followed by a positive, but this is a positive followed by a negative because Gideon said, but sir, you don't know what you're talking about. Okay, he actually says, pardon me, my lord. I assume he's like really sarcastic in his tone. That's the way I'm reading. Pardon me, my lord. Gideon replied, but if the Lord is with us, why has all this happened to us? You ever ask the question, why is all this happening? Why is this happening? I ask it all the time. Gideon, he probably already had this argument played out in his head 1,000 times over. Okay, mom, dad, I heard what you're talking about. Jesus, when God parted the Red Sea, we walked right out of Egypt. Yay, but I haven't seen Jack. Okay, thanks. That's a cool story. But it honestly sounds like Gideon's even beginning to doubt that that thing ever happened. It's like just old folklore. His reply, but sir, if the Lord is with us, why is all this happening? Where are all the wonders that our fathers told us about? And this isn't even to mention that Gideon was so unimpressed with the angel of the Lord who appeared to Gideon. That's what it says, right? Verse 11. The angel of the Lord came and sat down. I think if I would have seen an angel, I would probably freaked out and peed a little bit. But that's just me. Gideon was so unimpressed. Well, when an angel shows up to a person in the Bible, what are the first two words out of his mouth? Y'all remember? Yeah, don't be afraid. Fear not. That's the most common thing that an angel says to somebody. Fear not. But not Gideon. It seems like he was so numb to the presence of God that he would rather argue than appreciate the company that he was in. Cool, you're an angel of the Lord. You haven't done anything for me, so thanks. But sir, was Gideon so blinded by his circumstances that he couldn't see the potential behind his preparation? All this thrashing wheat, this hard work, the developing this work ethic, is what sets him up to be one of the greatest leaders in history. Later in the next chapter, I believe, in the next chapter, Gideon leads an army of 22,000 men to conquer 100,000 men. And God says, whoa, bro, you have too many men. And Gideon's like, I'm already like 18 against 1 here, but God said, no, you've got too many men. You need to get rid of 10,000. So he sent 10,000 home. He said, no, you still got too many. Send all of them, but these 300 home. And this guy took his 300 men and killed 100,000 of the enemy. But what we find in the chapter right before this amazing thing happens, he's hiding from the same people he's about to kill. Because he can't see past his own circumstance. But sir, you have no idea what you're talking about. But I know, and you know, that God works out all things for the good of those who love God and are called according to his purpose. Sometimes we allow our circumstance to blind us to the potential beneath the preparation. And so sometimes we stop preparing. Sometimes we just kind of half-heartedly go through the motions. When God's saying, the only thing you're accomplishing by acting like a snotty little brat, I don't want to do it. All you're really doing is closing your potential off. When you have the potential to explode from here to here, I don't want to do it. You're only going from like here to here. Our circumstances have to change the way we perceive what we see as a situation or as a circumstance, or why is all this happening? To, okay, what's God preparing me for? What is God amping up my potential to explode into in a minute? Verse 14. Here's the angel's reply to Gideon's little hissy fit. Go in the strength that you have. Go in the strength that you have. He looked at Gideon and said, bro, you do you. You be you. Don't try to be someone else. You be you. Okay. I'll be me. I'm a farmer. God hasn't called you. He hasn't called you to be me. He hasn't called you to be your best friend. He hasn't called you to be your mom and dad. He hasn't called you to be your idol. He hasn't called you to be Steph Curry. He hasn't called you to be Adele. He called you to be you. God is not in the business of blessing fake. Whatever dreams and destinies God has set up for somebody else is not what He set up for you. So when you pretend to try to be somebody else in order to gain their blessing, their level of potential explosion, God doesn't bless fake. God blesses you and the thing He set up you for. God blesses you. When we pretend to be someone or some way other than ourselves, all we're working with is our hopes and our dreams instead of our God-given gifts, skills, and talents. Go in the strength that you already have. God created you with everything you need to accomplish your destiny. If I don't have it, I don't need it. Now that's a whole lot easier than said. So let's practice that. Say, if I don't have it, I don't need it. That's a lot more difficult to walk out than it is just to say. Because when you're looking around and your family's falling apart, mom and dad are splitting up. That looks a lot different when you live that thing out. I'm not saying it's anybody's destiny to split up. It's not God's plan. But if God has created us with everything that we need to go in the strength that we already have, pretending to have somebody else's strength isn't going to do it for you. Go in the strength that you have. Go in the strength that you have. Part of that strength is knowing that the Lord is with you. So when we try to do things alone, it ends up as catastrophe. It ends up just terrible. We tend to mess things up when we try to do it ourselves. But when we go in the knowledge that the Lord is with us, it's guaranteed success. God's not going to set you up for failure. That's not what He does. He created you for a purpose and gave you everything right in your very hands to accomplish that very purpose. Let's keep moving. Verse 15. Pardon me, my Lord. Goodness gracious, what a dummy. But Lord, my Bible says, but Lord, there's another Bible, but go in the strength you have. But Lord, this is where, right here, is where I think we find ourselves a lot. Like, just listen, I'll show you. It says this. Gideon asks, how can I save Israel? My clan is the weakest in Manasseh, and I am the least in my least family. We can only view the negative things about ourselves. We have such a hard time looking ourselves in the mirror and saying, you know what? I am who God called me to be. We have a hard time looking at ourselves and taking an objective look and seeing the potential behind our preparation, because all we can see is the destruction, the last stupid decision we made. But Lord, you're still wrong. He's basically saying, I don't care that you're with me, I don't care that you redefined my destiny, and I don't care that you've already given me all the strength that I need. But Lord, you hear that whining? Oh my goodness. I have a hard time dealing with whining people. Both of my little boys, I've got a 4-year-old and a 3-year-old, and they know how to whine. I don't know why, because they also know that if they whine for no reason, they're going to get a spanking. And I ask them all the time, what happens when we whine? Well, we get a spanking. Okay. But Dad, let's go. We go get a spanking. There. Pardon me, my Lord. How can I save Israel? I'm nothing. We can look at ourselves and see nothing when we compare our preparation to somebody else's exploding potential. When we look at somebody else and see the the blessings that they have, the nice things and the great life that they have, and we're just still here, we don't understand that they had to go through a process as well. We don't understand that the process for them looked a lot like the preparation that you're in. Make sense?
Yeah.
Sweet. But Lord, obviously, the angel of the Lord here made a mistake. This is what's going through from Gideon's mind. Alright, you're wrong. I don't want to tell you you're wrong anymore, so let me say it nicely. Here's the reason why. And a lot of us have great excuses why we can't do something for Jesus. Well, my family is terrible, and I'm the worst one in it. I'm the worst one in my family. That's what Gideon used. It's the same excuse that he used. These excuses are terrible. But why would we allow our insecurities to upstage God's effectiveness? God's effectiveness has nothing to do with our insecurities or our inefficiencies. God's effectiveness solely relies on God's effectiveness. We are simply just a vessel that He uses because He loves us. He doesn't want to have to do things by Himself, so He created us to work alongside with Him to accomplish the destiny that He's put in front of Him. But God, no. Nothing. The Lord is with you. That's enough. Mighty warrior. God will redefine your destiny. He will look at you. He will call out the warrior from within the farmer. He'll look at your situation and say, what you're preparing for is exactly where what you need to be doing for the purpose and the potential that I've got placed inside of you. Mighty warrior, go in the strength you have. Why? Because with Jesus, with Him, with the Lord is with you is all that you need. Sometimes we've been asking, do I even have what it takes? Maybe we've even had a glimpse of, this is what I want to do. This is what I think I should be doing in my life. And we're saying, do I have what it takes? And God is screaming back at you, will you not use what you already have? Go in the strength that you have. Use what you have. Jesus said, the first will be last, and the last will be first. If Gideon's claiming to be the least good, that's where he needs to be. If you are claiming, if I'm claiming to be the least good, not degrading myself, not beating myself down, not beating myself up because I'm just negative all the time, but in a time of humility before the Lord, saying, God, I am the least. Without you, I am nothing. Where Jesus said, those who humble themselves will be exalted, and those who exalt themselves will be humbled. The first will be last, and the last will be first. Verse 16 again, the angel says the same thing he said in the very beginning. I will be with you. Why would he use the same argument that he used initially that he got argued back twice with? Right. It's true. You're right, Abby. And that's all that matters. The Lord is with you. No matter where you go, no matter who you want to be, the Lord is with you. No matter what situation you find yourself preparing in right now, no matter where you think you're going tomorrow, the Lord is with you. It's time for you to do something, because everybody can do something. It's time that we realize what our purpose is. It's time that we live beyond ourselves. And for a lot of us, that's really hard, because all we can see is our situation right in front of our face. We can't see it for the preparation of the potential we're about to explode into. But it's time. So the theme of Speed the Light this year is it's time. And I completely agree. I couldn't agree more. It is absolutely time for students like you, for people like me to step up and step out for Jesus and say, you know what? I'm going to live beyond myself.